Senator Boxer, you know Washington well, so I want you to give us a bit of a history lesson. As you know, Congress is extremely divided right now. The American people not having a lot of confidence in what's happening there. Is there a time? I mean, you were in D.C. when we were dealing with an impeachment, a government being shut down, wartime, terrorist attacks. Can you recall a time where we were this divided?
Truly, I can't, because even with all those issues you mentioned, there was always a path forward. I'm not that pessimistic about the Senate, because remember, everyone in the Senate represents their entire state. So there's a little bit more room to work together. But I think the House has gotten pretty bad. I started out, people don't remember this because it's so long ago, in the 80s, I got elected to the House. And it was the time of Ronald Reagan, and I obviously, as a Democrat, did not support a lot of his policies. But I want to say, even with that, we were able to pass amazing immigration legislation, which made citizens of those immigrants who were there in America for many years. So that was an amnesty bill that Ronald Reagan brought forward, and it had strong bipartisan support. We also had support to save Social Security under Ronald Reagan. It was having trouble, and we had to make some decisions. And we worked with him and got it done. Those are huge. Today, if you look at those issues, they are terribly partisan. And most Republicans don't want to do a thing about immigration. They want Democrats to just get in trouble with it. They don't care. It's very, very, very sad. And Social Security, they want to put it on the chopping block. So times have changed. But I do want to say, to the minute I left the United States Senate, and I got there in the 90s, I left the House because Newt Gingrich was, if those of you remember, when he came in, he was very, very antagonistic towards Democrats. He called us traitors, unpatriotic, guilty of treason. I don't even know how he came to all of that. It was awful. He hired this guy who gave him all the language to make us look like demons. It was just awful. It's one of the reasons I left the House, because I had a safe seat after 10 years. And I'm just going to go for the gold. I'm going to the Senate. If I don't get there, it's fine. And when I got to the Senate, what I found out is I could always find a sweet spot for legislation. And to the day I left, just a few days before I left, I had carved out a beautiful highway bill, a water bill with my counterpart, Jim Inhofe. He and I never agreed on anything, but we managed to come together. So there is always hope that individuals will find the sweet spot. But it's rough. Back to your point, I don't remember it ever being so partisan as it is today.
Yeah, serving in the House from 83 to 93, then going from the gold in 93, serving to 2017. But some of the issues that are being debated still were when you were serving in Congress. Gun legislation, we're now back to abortion rights. But I want to talk about same-sex marriage, because over the past couple of weeks, we've seen some interesting movements on that. You spoke on the Senate floor back in 96 during the debate over the Defense of Marriage Act, and you called it political ugliness. I'm paraphrasing here, and saying this is going to divide our country. Mind you, that's when Bill Clinton was president, a Democrat signed that bill. Now, under Joe Biden, you have Republicans that are signing on to this Respect for Marriage Act, and it seems like we've seen some change in those areas, but the country has also moved as well.
Well, that's you just hit the nail on the head. Nancy Pelosi has a very wonderful quote she uses from Abe Lincoln. Public sentiment is everything. So, honestly, it doesn't take much courage now to walk down that aisle and cast your vote for gay marriage. The country wants it. They understand it. If you love someone, what the heck is the government doing in the middle of that decision? It's ridiculous. I mean, you know, if I was younger now and I was dating someone, I wouldn't call Mitch McConnell to ask his permission. The whole thing's ridiculous. Stay out of the way. So it's very interesting you bring it up, because when I was there, it was one of 14 out of 100 to vote against the Defense of Marriage Act, which Bill Clinton signed. that was bipartisan opposition to gay marriage. And public sentiment is everything. And now they cancel that out. I'm so happy. That was 1996. It was such a dark day for me. And now we see this is protected. I do want to make the point that Clarence Thomas opened the door to this legislation when he threatened to overturn Obergefell, which is the court case that legalized same-sex marriage throughout the country. He threatened to turn that over. So I thought it was awful that he did it, also threatening interracial marriage. So the Senate and the House came together in one of these rare moments, one of these great moments, and said, no, you know, we're going to protect that.
All right, you mentioned Speaker Pelosi, the Respect for Marriage Act, one of her the last item she's presiding over is she is stepping aside, of course, still going to be a member of Congress, but not in leadership. What do you think her legacy is going to be?
Well, I'd say greatest of all time. And the reason I say it is I did serve in the House for 10 years. She came in just a few years after I did, and I watched her. And she had the ability to lead others just in her bones. And if I could just say, it's hard for me to express to you what it means that a woman can gain the trust of so many men in positions of power, and they chose to make her the most powerful of all. I mean, it takes an extraordinary amount of trust that she was given and faith in her, and it was certainly borne out. She knows how to count. She was the whip, so she was first in charge of getting that vote count right. You know, when Nancy Pelosi brings something to the floor, she's got the votes or she's not going to bring it to the floor. And the reason I say greatest of all time, it's not just because she's my friend and I think she's great. It's because she had such a small majority to work with, just a few votes. And, you know, the Democratic Party is very, very diverse. You've got, you know, center, right of center, left of center, and she could work it out and make sure people understood. Progress sometimes is a little bit at a time. So she was able to coalesce all those folks.
In terms of 2024, I want to pivot to that now and ask you your thoughts on that. I know that we're about to enter 2023, but the talk about the presidential election is going to be top of mind when we have the former president, Donald Trump, already announcing on the Republican side. And whether Joe Biden is going to run, that's still sort of up in the air. He said he's been discussing it with his family. And there has been some talk, you know, that Kamala Harris might not be that formidable of a candidate if Joe Biden were to step aside. So what are your thoughts on 2024 and what the Democrats should do?
Listen, it's, again, public sentiment. Who's out there? And the fact is, Joe Biden is underestimated. I know he's of a certain age. I'm of a certain age. Some people are fine at a certain age, and some people are not. Some people are bad at 50. They don't know, you know, their right hand from their left. It depends on the person. So I think he is so underestimated. And if he keeps having the success he's having in terms of fighting climate change, in terms of making life better with better jobs and all of the things that he has done, on and on, student loans, all the rest, fighting for democracy, getting hostages back. I mean, there's just a whole list of things we could go on and on. He's underestimated. Now, what Trump does is another kettle of fish. My view is Trump is such a narcissist. This is me speaking. I've never seen anything like it. His big announcement that he talked about and everyone was waiting for was that he's going to have a baseball card with him on it, different poses. Great. I mean, it's going to cost $100. It's another way to get people to part with their money for one of his causes. So my view is that he will run. And even if he loses the primary, which he might, he'll stay in there, run as an independent and mess things up. I think, I'm just guessing, I could be so wrong on this because he could actually be indicted. I don't know. But it's all interesting to put your thinking cap on and think of all the things. But it's hard for me to imagine him going down without destroying every other Republican in the race, as well as every Democrat he He's used to that.
Well, you said this twice in your response to that question. Biden is underestimated. Why is he underestimated? You tick through a long laundry list there of priorities that for Democrats, and he's seen success on them. So why is there still this question, do you think, looming out there? Should he run again? Is he too old?
Well, here's the deal. I left out one big one, infrastructure. You know, it wasn't a month that went by that Trump didn't say, this is going to be infrastructure year, infrastructure month, infrastructure day, infrastructure minute. And Joe Biden gets it done with bipartisan vote. Why is he underestimated? He's not one of these people who is a great speaker. And, you know, he doesn't come on there and he has a stutter that he had since he's a kid. He's not a great public speaker. So, but people see his kindness and they don't often see his amazing ability in foreign policy. Look what he's done to help Ukraine. In a very awful situation, terrible situation, people getting killed for what reason? Because Vladimir Putin doesn't like them and wants to take over their country. They didn't do anything to deserve it. And yet it was so dangerous for us to get involved. And so he carved out just the right path, I think, on this. So underestimated because maybe his style isn't that great. And he's older and maybe his words don't come out as smoothly as some others. But we'll see. You know, again, I get back to public sentiment. Let's see who else could have done the things this man did in terms of, you know, jobs, 10 million jobs in 2 years. Trump lost 1,300,000 jobs in 4 years. I mean, Joe Biden's he has actually made history with this job creation. So important. You know, solve the rail impasse. I mean, that was tough, and he's still going to fight for a sick leave, but he had the courage to do it. A lot of courage in that man. You know, when you've seen a lot of the despair he has suffered, he has courage.
So do you think Democrats need to do a better job at messaging all of those accomplishments in 2024?
Well, I hate the word messaging. I mean, people are going to feel it. They're going to see it. And yes, it ought to be pointed out. For example, if I were still in the Senate and we have, you know, two senators and they will do this, when the funds start flowing, for example, from the infrastructure bill or from the climate bill that result in clean energy jobs, jobs building freeways, highways, making our roads safer, making our bridges safer, I would get out there as a member of Congress and tell the tale. The only reason this is happening, our president pushed it, we voted for it, and here it is. I think you're going to see that happening because a lot of the bills he signed, you know, they're just now coming to fruition. So I think people will see it. I hate the word messaging. I want people to see it. And I think rather than calling it messaging, I think we ought to point out very clearly, you know, what's happening to people's lives and how they're being made better. And we can always do more, and we will. And also what's going to happen is I think the House is going to be so far to the right. All they're going to want to do is investigate Joe Biden, investigate his son and all. And after a while, you know, there's a sympathy for someone who's being treated that way at a time when we have so much else to work on. So I think the Republicans could trip over themselves, but guess what? I'm not a great person in terms of predicting the future. But today I feel that public sentiment is everything. And if we show people what this president of the Democrats have done, we should do very well in 2024, just like we made history in the midterms with the winds of history against us, right, blowing in our face. And we did so much better holding the Senate, actually picking up a seat. And the losses in the House, quite minimal.
All right, we will leave it there. Former Senator Barbara Boxer, we appreciate your time here on Inside California Politics, pulling out your political crystal ball and giving us also a trip down memory lane in the Senate. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much.